Thank you. And we will now move on to the next item of business. And the next item of business is a debate on motion 13758 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on Scottish Elections Representation and Reform Bill at Stage 1. I would invite those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons. And I call on Jamie Hepburn, Minister, to speak to and to move the motion. Up to 9 minutes, please.
Thank you, President Officer. I'm very pleased to open the Stage 1 debate of the Scottish Elections Representation and Reform Bill. I'd first of all like to thank those who engaged in the public consultation ahead of developing this bill. That is always an important part of our process, and I'm grateful for those who did so. I'm also very grateful to the committees involved in scrutinising the bill, in particular the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. I'm very pleased that its Stage 1 report supports the bill's principles, and I look forward to hearing from the committee convener in a few moments, just as I look forward to working closely with the committee and others as it continues its passage through Parliament. I'd also like to thank my predecessor, my friend George Adam, who developed the bill's proposals. The effort he undertook in engaging with a range of people and organisations and this Parliament in developing and forming the proposals within the bill is something I am very grateful for, and I can assure you and other members an approach I am committed to continue. President Officers, we mark a quarter century of the Parliament's first elections. The Scottish Election Bill is an example of the positive changes that this Parliament has made in how elections are run, always seeking to put people first. Whilst it has been... indeed.
Daniel Johnson.
He makes a very good point about this being about the Parliament, but does it strike him as odd that these are proposals being brought forward by the Government and the Executive? And as we consider how we make these sorts of changes in the future, does he think there should be a greater role for Parliament to both look and instigate and initiate these, rather than these being Government-initiated changes?
Well, I would say it's always in the hands of Parliament to initiate any proposals it wants to, and I think we'll probably come to discuss some in a short while. Mr Simpson is, I think, speaking today, and he has some proposals in this area. Other members are, of course, able to do so. Any committee of Parliament is able to do so, in particular the Standards Public Appointments Committee. So I'm always up for that approach, and, of course, the Government will always cooperate as such. And indeed, I was just about to make the point, whilst it has been brought forward by the Scottish Government, I do believe that this is Parliament's bill, and I hope it will command the support of all colleagues here. The bill covers a range of issues reforming Scottish Parliament and local government elections, carry forward government commitments to extending candidacy rights and improving accessibility for voters. It reforms our key electoral organisations and also addresses issues arising from the UK Elections Act 2022, especially in campaign finance, and builds on experience from the pandemic. The bill extends candidacy rights at Scottish Parliament local government elections to foreign nationals with limited leave to remain. It seems right that those who can vote in their elections should also be able to stand for election unless there are strong reasons otherwise. President Officer, I would highlight the powerful evidence provided to the committee on the impact of changes already made by this Parliament on voting rights for foreign nationals. Alam Hamoud Al-Bashiri of the Scottish Refugee Council told the committee, and I quote precisely, "I am so happy that in 2020 the right to vote in Scotland was given to refugees, and I, as a refugee, can vote in national and local elections here. In 2021, when I went to cast my vote for the first time, it was one of the most beautiful moments of my life. I am so glad that I chose Scotland to make Scotland my country." That's a sentiment that many of us who have taken for granted our right to vote may have underestimated or may not fully appreciate. They are powerful words that bring home the real impact of what changes to voting rights bring people and how it can involve them in this vital tenet of democratic elections. I was therefore pleased to see that Stage 1 report welcomed the proposed extension of candidacy rights. All of us here have been candidates for election, often many times, and for many of us, for more than just this Parliament, some of us had varying degrees of success in doing so at different points, but we have all gone through the process of being a candidate. We are aware of the risks faced by those standing for public office. It's crucial that campaigners, candidates and those running elections who face the risk of abuse in what should be a safe environment feel secure, and that action is taken if they do not. That's why the bill builds on the UK Elections Act to allow a court to bar from becoming MSPs and councillors those found guilty of offences involving intimidation of campaigners, candidates and elected representatives. It also goes further than the UK Act by allowing those found guilty of offences involving intimidation of electoral workers to be disqualified. I hope this sends a very strong, a very clear message to those who administer our elections that any intimidation or abuse against them is unacceptable and should not be tolerated. The bill makes a further change in disqualification, so future changes to House of Commons eligibility rules no longer automatically apply to MSPs. Further changes on disqualification are also planned for Stage 2. We have sort of used ahead of bringing amendments to disqualify sex offenders from becoming MSPs and councillors. And as I mentioned in a few moments ago in response to Mr Johnson, we are aware of Mr Simpson's proposed removal from office and recall members' bill. I have been very grateful to him to have had the chance to have what I believe, and I hope he would concur, are constructive discussions around that proposed legislation, which has three elements. One is a system of recall similar to the process introduced for MPs, and which was a motion with substantial cross-party support just a few weeks ago in this Parliament. Another is about removal from office due to a lack of participation, and a third on the threshold for criminal conviction to disqualify people from elected office. I have been discussing the detail of those matters with Mr Simpson. As I said, I intend to continue this work over the coming period ahead of Stage 2 to assess any possible implications for this bill we are debating today. Presiding officer, on campaigning in general, the bill broadly mirrors the UK's Elections Act on spending during election campaigns, redefining notional expenditure, limiting overseas spending and modifying third-party campaigning costs. These changes would simplify the law and have been broadly welcomed. On digital imprints, the actions of the UK Government have left us with little choice but to repeal the existing Scottish rules, which were the first in the UK and have operated successfully. The UK Government chose to pursue a broad reading of the Internet Services Reservation that we continue to think incorrect. The bill responds to that unilateral change. We have, however, retained one aspect in discussion with the Electoral Commission, so an imprint is required on unpaid-for material posted not just by a regulated campaigner, but all organisations. We see this as addressing an important gap. The committee's Stage 1 report highlights concerns about the enforcement and oversight of these measures, and I intend to engage closely with stakeholders to ensure concerns are addressed. The bill also builds on lessons learned during the pandemic on the emergency rescheduling of elections. We've been clear these proposals are only for situations where a delay is essential, such as a public health emergency. The Standards Committee called for those making postponement decisions, for example, the presiding officer or the convener of the Electoral Management Board, to provide a written statement of reasons for that decision. I'll bring forward an amendment to that effect. I've also noted the proposal from electoral administrators that the maximum period for a delayed council election should be 4 weeks rather than two, and intend to bring forward an amendment at Stage 2 to reflect this. Presiding officer, we all want the highest possible participation and registration for elections and for Scotland's citizens to be actively involved in our democracy. To that end, the bill makes provision on electoral innovation pilots. At present, only councils can propose pilots. The bill will allow schemes to be proposed by the Electoral Management Board, electoral registration officers and ministers. Piloting allows us to test whether potential changes and innovations will work in practice. And the current election campaign has again highlighted the need to help people with sight loss to vote independently. Pilots should be able to help people register to vote, and I intend to bring forward an amendment to clarify that changes to the registration system can be piloted. President, officer, there is much else the bill seeks to do. I don't have time in this opening part to speak to all, but I'll speak to more as I come to close. I look forward to hearing the contributions of members, but let me close by citing the evidence provided the Electoral Reform Society to committee. It's also important not to focus only on elections, but to think about the opportunities to strengthen our democracy in the period between elections too. This bill is designed to help that effort, and as such, I move the motion in my name.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Martin Whitfield on behalf of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. And as convener of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee, it is my pleasure to speak on behalf of the committee. It is an opportune time, of course, to be debating electoral law, and I'm sure all members here would join me in encouraging people who are able to vote next week and actually to continue voting in future elections to which this bill relates, because our democracy is founded on that moment when a person makes a decision about who they wish to represent them. I would, to echo the Minister, like to thank all of those who provided written and oral evidence on the bill, as well as all my fellow committee members for their constructive way in which they approached the committee's Stage 1 report. The committee supports the general principles of the bill, although there are a number of matters on which we either call for further clarification in advance of Stage 2 or where we have already suggested changes to the government. And I welcome the openness to which the current minister and his predecessor have been towards the committee to take advice, to discuss and hopefully to be able to reach satisfactory conclusions. The Scottish Government has provided a response to the committee's report, indicating an openness to consider a number of the recommendations the committee has made for amendments, and I'm grateful for this. The bill covers a number of very different aspects of electoral law, and I won't speak to every detail of the bill, but will cover the committee's main conclusions and recommendations. I will, however, urge all members and those outside of this place to read the report, Stage 1, listen to the debate today, and engage over the recess period so that changes, amendments and ideas can be brought forward in a timely manner. The committee... Happy to give way to...
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to Martin Whitfield for giving way. Given that so much of this bill is in essence a framework bill and will rely on secondary legislation, I'm just wondering if the convener of the Standards Privilege Committee could outline what his view is about how such secondary legislation should be drafted, reviewed and amended so that it can genuinely be a cross-party, because that is ultimately where much of the detail will actually be embodied.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful for that intervention. And if I can disagree with my colleague in respect of it, it is not simply a framework bill in the style that we have seen others. There is much that is delved into this. But there is, and you will pick up in due course and will have already done so from the report, a level of criticism, maybe that's too strong a word, a view of inquiry as to the extent of secondary legislation, because it does go to the heart of this about who should control our electoral methods. Is it, and indeed should it be, this Parliament? And we've already had the indication from the Minister of the ability of the Parliament to launch opportunities, indications and changes, or should it sit with a government? So we will pursue inquiry on that as we go forward. The committee supports the extension of candidacy rights to individuals with limited leave to remain. The majority of those who provided evidence to the committee welcomed the proposals. There are, however, some concerns in the evidence about the potential risk that it could be used by foreign players to undermine Scotland's electoral system, and the committee has invited the Scottish Government to make further consideration of those risks. The bill also introduces a Scottish disqualification order, which would disqualify an individual subject to an order from standing for election to the Scottish Parliament and or our local government in Scotland for a period of 5 years. It also provides that where an individual is convicted of certain offences and the court believes beyond reasonable doubt that the offence was aggravated by hostility related to electoral workers, the court will, in most cases, be required to impose an additional sanction of a disqualification order. The committee is content with the provisions on disqualification, but noted a potential risk of vexatious candidacy for the Scottish Parliament elections, as the bill does not prevent an individual subject to such an order from actually standing for election, merely taking up the role. And the committee notes the reference provided by the Minister that the elections order offers sufficient safeguarding. The committee has asked the Scottish Government to keep this issue under review and to consider future amendments via primary legislation should any issues of vexatious candidacy transpire. The committee also invites the Scottish Government to carry out an evaluation of the impact of the proposed changes in relation to increasing the diversity of those campaigning or standing for elected office and to the levels of abuse and intimidation, particularly women and minority candidates experience. The policy memorandum for the bill indicated that the government would welcome the committee's view on the introduction of a provision to provide for the disqualification of individuals who are subject to sex offender notification requirements from being MSPs or indeed councillors. Responses to the committee indicated stakeholder support for the introduction of such a provision. The committee also noted that other legislatures in the UK have brought forward legislation in this area. The committee supports the introduction of this provision in principle, but detailed scrutiny of how such provision could or indeed should operate is not possible without sight of specific legislative proposals, and the committee looks forward to engaging with the government on this issue ahead of stage two. On campaign spending, the committee has made a number of recommendations for the Scottish Government in relation to campaign expenditure in its stage one report. These include: the Electoral Commission should be consulted before Scottish ministers add a category to the list of third-party campaigners. Scottish Government should undertake work with relevant stakeholders to consider how the range of campaign expenses could be increased to support increased diversity in candidates for elected office, such as, but not restricted to, childcare costs. In relation to restrictions on spending by overseas third-party campaigners, the Scottish Government provides further information on how it intends such restrictions to be enforced. The Scottish Government undertakes further work with stakeholders to bring the reporting regime for Scottish Parliament elections into line with the regime for the UK Parliament elections. The committee welcomes the consideration that has been given to providing greater flexibility in relation to the rescheduling of Scottish elections. Concerns were raised to us by the electoral administrators in relation to the minimum period, but the Minister has already covered the intentions on this. We also recognised and emphasises the importance of clarity and transparency in relation to the decisions to reschedule elections, and the committee considers that the provisions in the bill could be strengthened by the additional requirement of a statement of reasons explaining why an election is being rescheduled. We are largely content with the provisions of the bill in relation to election pilots and the establishment of a democratic engagement fund, but we ask the Scottish Government to take into account the number of recommendations in the report, including mechanisms for election pilots and specifying the amount of funding available in the democratic engagement fund. I realise time is short, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I will push on swiftly. The committee supports the proposed revision to extend the deadline for the Boundaries Review Scotland to submit its next report in relation to council wards and councillor numbers from the 31st of December 2028 until the 30th of April 2031, and we welcome the commitment from the Scottish Government to look at automaticity as the way forward to set out details of their proposals in relation to this before stage three. The Electoral Management Board plays an important role in the elections, and the committee welcomes and supports the establishment of the Electoral Management Board as a body corporate so that it can undertake contracts and facilitate the provision of elections better. The committee has called on more clarity from the Scottish Government around a significant number of areas which could be taken forward by secondary legislation, and the committee would like to know when it can expect to receive the additional information. The committee asks for this to be well in advance of the secondary legislation being laid. The committee would also like for clarification in respect of when the relevant secondary legislation, whether that outlined in the Minister's letter already received or in advance of the next parliamentary elections. The committee looks forward to working with the Scottish Government and indeed all members across the chamber with regard to this, which I do believe is a very important bill. And we are reminded of the Gould principles that any amendments to any election rules should take place sufficiently far from that election so everyone understands it, and not less than 6 months. I am grateful for your patience, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. I would advise the Chamber we do actually have some time in hand, but I'll leave that to members to decide how they wish to use that or not, as the case may be. I now call on Graeme Simpson on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Around 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. Can I start by thanking the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointment Committee for their excellent and detailed report into this bill. I hope to be working very closely with the committee on my own bill, which you've heard about already, in which there are some crossover issues with this one later this year, so I want to keep in with them and their fantastic convener. At this stage, we're looking at the general principles of the bill, which are to make further provision about eligibility of elected representatives in the Scottish Parliament and in local government, and to reform certain aspects of the law relating to Scottish parliamentary and local government elections. And the committee agrees with the general principles, and so do we on this side of the chamber. But their report goes into detail on some very important areas. The bill gives foreign nationals with any form of leave to remain the right to stand as a candidate in Scottish local government elections and Scottish Parliament elections. And currently, they can only stand for the Scottish Parliament if they have indefinite leave to remain. The new proposal could, of course, mean that someone could be elected with no guarantee of being able to stay for their full term. And that must be an issue. There's also the question, picked up by the committee, of whether there is a tension between the oath of allegiance that MSPs are required to swear and citizenship of another country. The then Minister, George Adam, responded that, quote, "There is always a debate about that and everyone has their own opinion on it, but it's up to each individual to consider how they deal with that when they put themselves forward as an elected member." And I think that response was a bit of a cop-out, to be honest. The bill... of course.
Minister. Yes.
He would presumably, though, recognise it's for each and every one of us standing for elected office on the basis that we may be elected, understanding that we would have to take such an oath. We have to reconcile ourselves to that fact and the full knowledge of that could happen.
Graeme Simpson.
It could happen. I also noticed Lorna Slater wanted in, which I will take her, but it could... Yes, that, of course that could happen. But I think the committee just picked up on the issue was if you know that you might not be able to serve your full term, I think that could be an issue that's worth exploring, possibly at stage two. And I'll take Lorna Slater.
Lorna Slater.
Thank the member very much for that. Of course, the member will recognise that many of us who serve in this chamber already are also citizens of other countries.
Graeme Simpson.
Absolutely, and that's a good thing. Now, the bill creates a new Scottish disqualification order which can apply to individuals found guilty of intimidating electoral workers. Malcolm Burr, convener of the Electoral Management Board, said, quote, "A lot of abusive comments are made off the cuff or are of the moment and probably would not be caught. One would hope that the possibility of a disqualification order would deter anyone with political ambitions who was minded to participate in a campaign of intimidation or a premeditated act of intimidation." I agree with that. The bill does not include provision for disqualification of individuals who have been convicted of a sexual offence and are subject to sex offender notification requirements from holding office as MSPs or councillors. But the policy memorandum to the bill indicates that consideration is being given to such a provision being introduced at stage two. I'd certainly be happy to look at that, but it may be better if the government does. And that brings me on to another issue highlighted in the policy memorandum, which I highlighted when I attended the committee on May the 2nd. Section 31 of the Local Government Scotland Act 1973 prevents individuals standing or holding office as a local authority member if they have, within 5 years prior to the day of the election or since their election, been jailed for no less than 3 months. But for elections to the Scottish Parliament, people are disqualified from standing or continuing to serve as an MSP if they've been sentenced to be imprisoned or detained for more than a year. And the justification for this approach, the difference in this approach, isn't clear. Now, as I've said, I've got a member's bill being drafted at the moment, which the committee will deal with. Part of my bill seeks to reduce that sentence limit for MSPs from over 12 months to 6 months. But that, of course, would still leave a disparity between the way councillors are treated and the way MSPs are treated, which I can see no justification for. So, as the Minister said, I have had some very fruitful discussions with him about this, and indeed the rest of my bill, because I think we do need to fix this. He and I agree, I'm not putting words into his mouth, but we ought to find a solution. But we need to decide on what the sentence should be that prevents someone from being a councillor or an MSP, and I think they need to be the same figure. And I'm confident that over the course of the summer, the Minister and I will arrive at an agreement. And I'll certainly table an amendment to that effect. But that would mean me not taking forward that element of my bill. The other sections of my bill on non-attendance and recall, I'm very strongly minded to keep, and that should keep the committee well occupied in the latter part of the year and maybe beyond. Now, the Elections Bill does a number of other things. It makes new provisions for campaign finance. It places a duty on the Electoral Commission to produce a statutory code of practice on the application of expenditure controls for third-party campaigners. It contains provisions to decide to postpone elections, widens powers to conduct a pilot on electoral processes and to adjust the date of the new review of local government wards and numbers of councillors. It would also change the law on digital imprints. There's a section in the committee's report on dual mandate. The most witnesses were, I think I'm right in saying, against that. There are differing views. There are differing views among MSPs. There are differing views in my own party. I note the committee didn't express a view. I'm personally against dual mandate. Presiding Officer, can I thank the committee once again, and I look forward to contributing to the progress of the bill.
Thank you, Mr Simpson. I now call on Daniel Johnson on behalf of Scottish Labour. Around 5 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank Graeme Simpson for giving us that briefest of insights and indeed hints into the internal machinations of the Scottish Conservative Group about dual mandates. Should probably leave that one there. But before I go further, I would just like to remind the Chamber of my register of interest. I'm a member of the Trade Unions Community and USDAW, and I'm also a Scottish Labour and Scottish Cooperative Party MSP, which I think is all relevant to this bill. This bill makes a number of very important changes to the way that people will seek to be elected to this place in future years. And I think it's really important that we continue to revise and refresh the rules and regulations, because that's part of a healthy democracy. Society changes, and making sure that we remain as accessible as possible, as inclusive as possible, is really very important. Now, I don't have time this afternoon to go through all the points and issues raised in this bill, but I would like to highlight a few. And I'd actually like to start with the points raised by the RNIB about accessibility, because they are very important. And indeed, it highlights an issue that was raised to me by one of my constituents, who was deeply frustrated about the lack of availability of voting devices. For those who have visual impairments, it can be incredibly difficult to register to vote, to get to the polls, and to use ballot papers. And it strikes me that it is not beyond the wit of human beings to provide people with visual impairments with that ability to vote. And yet, if you look at what's being proposed, it strikes me that we are behind the curve in terms of making technology available. And I think James Adams put that very well in his evidence from the RNIB in his evidence to the committee, stating that there's a large cohort of blind and partially sighted people who, if they could register with the local authority to receive their voting card by email or whatever electronic method, would be able to use screen readers on their phones. I think that is a simple and bold point. And I would actually suggest more broadly...
Minister?
I think Mr Johnson makes a number of reasonable points, and we will actively look at all these things, but just for his awareness in terms of the issue around those who might struggle to access ballot papers in the traditional format, I can let him know that ideas for tactile voting agents continue to be explored, and there is in fact a prototype of a card overlay that matches the size of the ballot paper being assessed, and end users are involved in its design and development. So these are things that we're actively looking at.
I'm aware of that. What I would urge the government is to accelerate and expedite those things, because that has been a very long, drawn-out process. There's a great deal of frustration with that. I'd also urge members to realise that visual impairment takes a broad range of forms. That not all people who are blind or visually impaired can use Braille, and so that you need a broad range of different devices for different people with different visual impairments. On extension of candidacy rights, I take a very broad principle, is that if you participate in society, if you pay your taxes, you contribute, and this is not an exhaustive or comprehensive list, then you should be able to put yourself forward for election. And I think in broad terms, I welcome the broadening of this category. I think I welcome the fact that there is a broader range of people that can vote in elections in this place. But I think we do need to look quite carefully at the criteria that are being proposed. I think that if people are here for just a temporary period of time, who have no expectation of residing in Scotland up to or even close to the point of the next election, I just wonder whether or not that has merit. And critically, I think we do need to consider the possibility that could be exploited by foreign powers or other agencies, i.e. sending people to this country in order to stand for elections, potentially using that to manipulate those elections. I think that is not a threat that is imminent, but I think it's one that we certainly need to consider the possibility of. I think Ms Dunbar was ahead of you, Minister, so I'd give way to her.
Jackie
first.
Dunbar. Jackie Dunbar, who's joining us remotely for an intervention. Ms Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to the Member for the intervention. You were saying that about people who were only going to be residing in Scotland temporarily. Are you taking in the rest of the UK in that regard, or like European nationals and other nationals?
Always through the chair, Daniel Johnson.
I thank the member for that point. I think we just need to think through this point carefully. I think that standing for election, I think you should be committed to representing the constituency of the region for the period of that parliament. And I think we should explore that as a point of discussion. I think I may be running out of time. But
no, it's good. Minister?
Just on that, first of all, Ms Dunbar is frequently ahead of me. I can assure Mr Johnson of that fact. I can see he agrees with me from a sedentary position. On his latter point around the concerns around manipulation and outside agencies, I agree with that, and I think we do need to consider that very carefully. Of course, that's a very serious matter for consideration. But in terms of strict criteria around who can and cannot be a candidate, I suppose I would ask him to reflect on the fact that not a single person here in advance of standing for election had to sign anything that said we are committed to living in Scotland for any form of extended period of time. The assumption, the expectation, of course, is that we would do so. That is no different from the current position we have just now.
Daniel Johnson.
And sometimes I think some of these things need to kind of come out through, and it's up to the voters to decide whether a person's commitment, whether it's to a time period or particular principles, are reasons to vote for them or not. And I note the time. I'd just like to briefly mention third-party campaigners. As I stated in my declaration, there are a broad range of third-party organisations that naturally participate. I think transparency is important, but as we consider these things, I think we need to recognise the fact that trade unions, campaigning bodies, and indeed allied parties are a healthy part of our democracy, and we should be in seeking to ensure that we don't put them at a disadvantage, but we also seek to promote transparency and clarity. And can I just very briefly, I do think we need to think about the possibility of committee bills to look at how we reform our democracy. There is a capacity that all committees have in this Parliament. It has never been taken up. But I think I do have concerns both about the fact that much of this detail is reliant on secondary legislation. I do think the committee needs to have early sight of that and the ability to contribute and amend it. But in the future, I would ask whether or not actually the SPPA itself should be the body or a similar body that can take forward proposals such as these on a genuinely cross-party basis, because I question the legitimacy of the executive taking forward proposals to reform elections, which I think are properly a matter for Parliament. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Johnson. I now call on Gillian Mackay on behalf of the Scottish Greens. Around 4 minutes, please.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Sometimes dramatic, sometimes mundane, and always interesting for those of us who are involved. Elections offer an incredible opportunity to voice our say about what values we want to be guiding the decisions that shape our country. Civil participation in our democracy is the only way to make it thrive. There are inherent values in voting which make it a foundational principle for healthy democracies. It fosters expressiveness, equality and legitimacy and serves as a very tangible link between residents and their representatives. And it's the bedrock of our governmental structure. This bill reminds us that this very institution is organic and welcomes expansion and inclusion. In contrast to those elsewhere in these aisles, that fight to conserve rigid and archaic structures devolution has allowed us to, in the relatively short history of this Parliament, institute large advances in expanding rights. We've charted a different path in Scotland, and I hope that we'll continue to expand and enhance access to our democratic institutions for everyone living here to feel listened to and represented. Votes at 16 for Scottish and local government elections is one of the greatest steps forward we've taken to extend the franchise, and we've seen how young people have engaged with electoral processes as well as politics as a whole, and it has certainly, I believe, had an effect on policy. I'd like to thank the clerks, the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee for their work, along with each and every one of those who took part in evidence sessions and the consultation. I'd also like to thank my good friend George Adam, MSP, for the work he put into this bill when he was Minister for Parliamentary Business. There's lots to welcome in this bill, and I note the general support and agreement of the committee in the Stage 1 report. I believe that Parts 1 and 2 of the bill, which extend candidacy rights at Scottish Parliament and council elections to those with limited leave to remain in the UK, are necessary and important changes. The right to vote for refugees was first brought to this chamber as part of a Green Amendment lodged in 2018 by my colleague Ross Greer that was supported by Labour, Lib Dem and SNP MSPs. We firmly believe that those residing in Scotland must be afforded the right to vote and decide how best they would like to be represented, and it's logical to enable those with the right to vote the right to stand at such elections. I'm also supportive of having a backstop provision for responding to any unanticipated events, such as a public health emergency, particularly in light of the impact on this chamber of the COVID-19 pandemic. Today, I'd also like to encourage bolder action from the Scottish Government. In 2019, my colleague Mark Ruskell, MSP, pressed for many of the provisions of this very bill, and the Scottish Greens have been leading at the forefront of several of these campaigns. We pressed for and continue to urge the expansion of voting rights to asylum seekers. I'm pleased to hear of the amendments that the Minister is looking to bring in, and I'm sure we will speak to him on amendments ahead of Stage 2. I was pleased to hear Daniel Johnson raise the issue of accessible voting. Earlier this session, I attended an event at the Sensory Centre in Falkirk about voting accessibility for those who are partially sighted or registered blind. Some of the technology that we saw was hugely important for those who required it, and that extends across those with various impairments and disabilities. Communicating changes to electoral systems and how we vote is also really important for those with varying impairments and disabilities, and that should be at the heart of anything that we do going forward. We must do more to renew our democracy and to encourage democratic participation at all levels. In fact, reform work still needs to be done in this session of the Scottish Parliament and should be a continuous endeavour. It's our view that there should be more radical view of democratic reform and voter turnout so that we can start to incentivise active citizens in our society. This is the correct step forward, and we will be supporting this bill at Stage 1.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. And we now move to the open debate, and I call Bob Doris to be followed by Annie Wells, and Mr Doris is joining us online. Mr Doris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'm pleased to speak in this short debate, Stage 1 debate on the Scottish Elections Bill, and my thanks to the committee for their sterling work and for their very informative and helpful Stage 1 report, and to the Minister for Parliamentary Business, Jamie Hepburn, MSP, and indeed to his predecessor, George Adam. I wish to discuss how we ensure that we use this legislation to make the most fundamental and core democratic function, casting one's vote, actually count. I have a direct constituency interest in this, but the points I make should be pertinent to all of us. At the 2022 Scottish Council elections, there was a spoiled ballot paper rate of 5.64% in Carroll Ward in my constituency. That was over three times the national average. Most were unintentionally spoiled. Carroll is a four-member ward with two parties fielding multiple candidates and a well-known independent candidate also on the ballot paper. Many voters indicated a first preference vote for more than one candidate, mostly placing two or three X's on the ballot paper. Parts of the ward has low income levels, indeed Postle Park, because there was challenging SIMD data in Scotland, and there's an enduring low turnout of voters, almost 14% lower than the Scottish average at the last council elections. The risk factors for things to go wrong were clear and evident. Let me view this through the prism of the bill we are scrutinising. In Part 5, there is the proposal for a Democratic Engagement Fund. £300,000 was suggested by the previous minister. And the policy memorandum states, where a grant or assistance scheme is put in place, that is expected to be focused on local organisations which work with harder to reach groups and have a clear objectives to improve democratic participation, such as through encouraging voter registration. We could add tackling patterns of low turnout and spoiled papers to that list and other factors. If it doesn't seek to tackle issues such as I have outlined in Canal Ward, then it will not be doing its job properly. We need more detail on the underlying principles for the strategic use of any given fund and how its effectiveness may be monitored. The Electoral Commission is also considering a similar fund, and that takes me to Part 8 of the bill. This looks at how five-year plans by the Electoral Commission are agreed by the Scottish Parliament's corporate body, including the budgets which will underpin them. I would welcome a statutory duty on the Electoral Commission for any strategic plan to tackle the kind of issues I have identified in Canal Ward. That position is shared by local council colleagues of mine, Councillor Gow and Councillor McLaren. Together we've met with the Electoral Commission to discuss further. I'm happy to take an intervention.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to Bob Doris for taking the intervention, and on that very point, but just before that, can I also thank him for the contribution that he made while on the committee. But on that very point, does he agree with me, as well as the items that he's discussing, that it should be for the Electoral Commission itself to control this five-year plan, rather than have the SPCB here able to alter it?
Bob Doris.
That's an interesting intervention. I would note that the Welsh Parliament and the UK Parliament has taken a different position from the one stated by the convener of the Standards Committee, but I do actually agree with the convener. But the underlying principles that support that plan, I think, should be set out on the face of the bill, but the plan itself would be for the Electoral Commission. Now, I've also met with both the previous minister and the Electoral Commission myself to further the proposals that I'm seeking to bring forward. The current duty on the Electoral Commission simply states to promote public awareness of, and I will quote, current electoral systems in the United Kingdom and any pending such systems, together with such matters connected with any such existing or pending systems as the Commission may determine. I think we can all agree that perhaps has to be clarified and brought into a bit more focus. It appears reasonable to me that this Parliament should reflect on the face of the bill some underlying principles that should guide those strategic plans, which will hopefully facilitate meaningful work and outcomes in our communities across Scotland, including Canal Ward that I have mentioned. I know the Electoral Commission are increasingly seeking to do more work in this area, and not only at election time. I look forward to exploring these opportunities ahead of Stage 2 to make votes count right across Scotland. And I look forward to working with the current Minister for Parliamentary Business to those ends. So thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Doris. I now call Annie Wells to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy. Ms Wells.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be speaking in today's debate on the Scottish Elections Representation and Reform Bill. And as a relatively newish member of the SPPA committee, it's been really interesting understanding where this bill is going. And as we've heard, the bill contains numerous proposals that aim to alter aspects of our electoral system. The suggested changes focus on voting, election schedules, campaigns and finance, administration and governance, and candidates. And on the issue of candidates, part two of the bill is dedicated to disqualification criteria and increasing the diversity of candidates. And concerning the former, the bill's policy memorandum suggests that consideration will be given at stage two to barring individuals who are sex offenders or who have been convicted of sexual offences under the Sexual Offences Act 2003 from becoming either councillors or members of this Parliament. Notably, this would be comparable to legislation passed by other legislatures, got that out, on this issue. When discussing the latter, particular attention has been given to increasing the role of women and minority candidates. These groups often experience larger degrees of abuse when standing for public office, and this is particularly present on online platforms, namely social media. To safeguard and improve such diversity, the Scottish Government has been asked by the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee to undertake an evaluation of the potential impact of these proposed changes made pertaining to individuals looking to campaign or run for office. And in response, the Scottish Government reiterated its commitment to increasing candidates' diversity for public office and agrees that conducting an evaluation of the impact of these changes before 2031 would help realise the same. Aside from individuals, the bill looks to widen democratic participation by enabling to offer financial support for activities deemed to be related to Holyrood elections or local government matters through a new democratic engagement fund and electoral pilots. Concerning the fund, this monetary assistance would be allocated to increase engagement of campaigners, candidates and voters. And despite no money being yet allocated and more clarification needed, the committee largely supported this proposal alongside those for election pilots. And with regards to electoral pilots, the bill would seek to amend the 2002 Scottish Local Government Elections Act, and this proposal is intended to provide greater accessibility to voters. For example, it was noted that election pilots could play a central role when considering automatic voter registration in the future. And like the Engagement Fund, this provision would at least in principle help make the Scottish voting system more equal and reachable to all voters in Scotland. To conclude, Presiding Officer, today's bill and its proposed changes to our electoral system are still very much in their infancy and is not, at least at this stage, an exhaustive bill. However, the general spirit of the bill aims to make our electoral system, the very mechanism we employ to exercise our democratic rights, more open and equal. It would refine the criteria for those individuals who wish to represent the Scottish people here at Holyrood or in local government, and these changes are aimed at making Scotland's electoral system both more accessible and structured around the will of the Scottish people. It is for these reasons I look forward to future debates and collaboration with colleagues to achieve these ends. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Wells. And I call on Pam Duncan-Glancy to be followed by Elena Whittam.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I'm pleased to speak this afternoon for Scottish Labour. As we've, colleagues have set out, we support reform, and as anyone who's been on a door or even read their inbox lately, they'll know that the appetite for change is indeed strong. People are fed up, partly because of what some people do when they're in office, but also because of the process to get here, as we've heard, in terms of the representation and difficulties for equalities groups. Setting the highest of standards in public life is not just about behaving better or making better decisions, although we must improve both. It's also about central to restoring trust between the public and politics. And there's a lot more, I think, that we can do on that, including around second jobs, introducing the right to recall for MSPs who have engaged in wrongdoing, and establishing stronger sanctions for breaches of ministerial codes. But also crucial to this is, of course, the ability to pilot improvements to increase participation, access and understanding in our politics, particularly for underrepresented groups, and it's to that that I want to turn to just now. Participation and representation matters, and I've spent much of my time in here and before I got here campaigning for better representation for women, disabled people, LGBT people, BAME people, in our homes, in our streets, in our councils, in our banks, in our bars, and indeed also in our parliaments. It's important that we see a whole diversity of society reflected here. And as it stands, our parliaments still fall short. So we know that women still make up only 34% of the UK Parliament as it was before it was dissolved, 46% of the Scottish Parliament. Less than 1% of MPs are disabled, and only 5% of MSPs are. Only 10% of MPs and 4.5% of MSPs are BAME. 7% of MPs are LGBT, and the figure is not available here. Data from Spice has said that it's difficult to gather this information because we do rely on people coming forward or coming out, as I've described it in the past. And we should take the opportunity in this bill, if we can, to try and address that. Because much does rely on the fear of saying that you might be a disabled person, for example. I don't have to say that, it's pretty obvious, but for some people it's not, that's not the case. And I think we should make it easier for people to do that. And it kind of, this issue goes quite far back, including as far back as President Roosevelt himself, who said he didn't declare his disability because of concerns around how it could be seen. So I think we need to sort that, and part of what we could do through this bill could be to address it. And we know that representation matters because we cannot continue to make the same decisions with the same people and expect different results. We have to get the innovation of all of Scottish society brought into these chambers and council chambers across the country. And we've made some steps in that sense, but we've still got far to go. I'm happy to take the intervention.
Graeme Simpson.
I thank Pam Duncan-Glancy for taking the intervention. I'm really interested in what she has to say here. I just wonder whether she has any specific proposals just yet, maybe she hasn't just yet, on the issues that she's raising.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the member for that intervention, and I'll come on to one specific example shortly, but there are other examples from across civic society. I know that in gender, for example, I've done some really good work looking at increasing the representation of women in politics that I think the Parliament should look to and learn from, as have other equality groups. And the bill in front of us, I think, really does present an opportunity to change things. I think we should seize the moment for the pilots. I agree with James Adams from RNIB, who said that blind and partially sighted people still don't feel they can vote in confidence or in secret, and that we need to change that. He said we should bite the bullet, and I hope that we can do that through this legislation, including on digital polling cards. I also think that we need to welcome the increase in participation through supporting a fund for participation. And the Electoral Commission and Engender and RNIB have suggested in their evidence that this would build capacity of civil society to reach underrepresented groups, and we should seize that. And finally, Deputy Presiding Officer, on the point of an example, the Access to Elected Office Fund was set up after cross-party campaigning and much support from the disability movement and effort from the disability movement to encourage more disabled people into politics. We should learn from that fund, and I'd be grateful if the Minister could confirm on the record this afternoon in his closing whether he will consider reopening that for the next Scottish Parliament election. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Duncan-Glancy. And I call Elena Whittam, who will be the last speaker in the open debate. Ms Whittam.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. We have before us a bill at stage one today that will go a long way to strengthening our democracy, both in this Parliament and across our council chambers. And I thank everyone who has engaged with it thus far. It does introduce provisions to expand candidacy rights, protect candidates and campaigners from intimidation, and improve administrative arrangements for elections in Scotland. This bill provides an opportunity to create an electoral system that improves democratic engagement, including for those who have chosen to make Scotland their home. In the short time that I have to speak today, I would like to focus my remarks on where I believe we can focus attention to improve the bill to ensure we deliver on the collective aim we have to positively enable a greater diversity in political representation. During my time as COSLA's community wellbeing spokesperson, along with the then COSLA President, Councillor Alison Everson, we convened a Barriers to Elected Office working group as we urgently wanted to understand why our council chambers were largely male and pale. At the time, with less than 30% women councillors and a very low number of people from minoritised communities or with disabilities. And then when we started to dig into intersectionality, it became very apparent that there was a mountain to climb before our council chambers, and indeed this very chamber we are in today, reflect the communities that we serve. And just as a little side note, I actually, along with Councillor Kelly Parry, did a wee act of breaking the glass ceiling a little bit, because we became the first community wellbeing spokespersons to job share, because she went on maternity leave. And both of us were paid the full salary. That was a first, and I think we need to recognise such achievements. I would like to thank Engender for the briefing that they provided MSPs for today's debate, and for their efforts to dismantle structural sexism, to increase women's social, political and economic equality. Like me, they know that by having women, disabled women, BME women, women who are carers and women on low incomes, in our chamber shaping policy and legislation, we make lives better. This is one of the key drivers for me when I first sought nomination. As a former women's aid worker, I saw local decision-making result in the tendering of our specialist service. And I wanted to be around the table to ensure our voices were heard and acted upon. And I often think of that saying, if you're not around the table, you're on the menu. What I didn't expect was the level of intimidation and misogyny I have encountered over the last 9 years in office. So there are a few ways that I think we can strengthen the bill to increase diversity and support the diversity when in office. First off, how do we know what we don't know? Without a duty on the Scottish Government to survey candidate diversity and experience at all future and local elections, we don't have robust equality monitoring data. Intersectional data on the protected characteristics of our elected representatives is vital in ensuring a high-quality democracy. And I will always campaign for disaggregated gender data. We just don't have enough of it. Secondly, candidate and elected member safety is absolutely key, as right now, the toxic levels of abuse and harassment are having a chilling effect on women's participation in politics and also in their decision as to whether they're going to stand again for elected office. Just last month, I was granted a 5-year non-harassment order, and I know I am but one of many politicians who have faced threats and intimidation. And like Engender, I would press the Scottish Government to look closely at incorporating the recommendations from the Joe Cox Civility Commission, and also to exempt costs associated with candidate safety from election spending limits. Thirdly, we need to provide financial support to ensure participation, and I, like Pam Duncan Glancy, also urged the Minister to look at the successful Access to Elected Office Fund that was administered by Inclusion Scotland, which helped to alleviate financial barriers faced by disabled candidates. Lastly, how can this Parliament, our councils and indeed our own political parties ensure that there is mentoring, support, coaching and training available to ensure those furthest from elected office are supported to get there, and when they're there, to stay there? This bill is our vehicle to increasing participation, and I urge members to support it today at stage one. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Whittam. We now move to closing speeches, and I call on Lorna Slater to close on behalf of the Scottish Greens. Around 4 minutes, please, Ms Slater.
Thank you very much. Democracy is a core value that everyone in this chamber shares, and radical local democracy is one of the four pillars of the international green movement. Democracy is a journey. It isn't something you do just once. It is a continuous process of achieving consent to govern. We are lucky enough to have lived so long in a democratic country with its peaceful transfer of power that I worry that many people have forgotten that the peace, freedom, and human rights that we enjoy are the products of democracy, and that undermining democracy places these invaluable things at risk. We live in times where the value of democracy and the legitimacy of its processes are being questioned around the world. Power does not want to hear truth. Power is selective about which people it wants to listen to. Even in the UK, the Conservative government brought in measures on purpose to make it harder for people to vote, by requiring ID to vote in UK elections, solving a non-existent problem of fraud, but exacerbating a real and chronic problem of voter turnout. We know who they don't want to listen to. We know this because they refuse to extend the franchise on purpose because they fear the will of the people, where the people include young people and immigrants who've come from certain places or under certain circumstances. I'm very proud that Scotland has updated and expanded the franchise, and that we have this new opportunity to visit and improve our democratic processes. On the journey of democracy, we must always check in and ask ourselves who is getting a say and whose voices are being excluded. One of the big challenges in our democracy right now is that a large proportion of people who have the right to vote do not. One of the purposes of democracy is rebalancing power from those who have it and to distribute it to the people. Who are the people in Scotland? Just those who are able to jump through the hoops of social norms, voter registration processes, getting into a voting station or getting leave from work or arranging a proxy or postal vote, and now, for UK elections, bringing an accepted form of ID. I have some suggestions for how we can make this easier for people who are allowed to vote, who may wish to vote, but are unable to navigate this landscape. Firstly, it should be an automatic expectation of every high school to support their students of 15 years or older to register to vote. There is strong evidence that people who start voting at 16 and 17 will continue to vote in higher numbers than those who become eligible when they are 18. I am, of course, very grateful to those schools who already do this.
Absolutely.
I'm very grateful to Lorna Slater for taking the intervention. We should go one step further than that and suggest that actually automatic registration at, say, 14, 15 should take place. And actually the obligation, the requirement on the schools is actually to facilitate an understanding of the democratic purpose above what it does already.
Lorna Slater.
Thank you very much for that intervention. I would be very happy to support automatic registration. What I'm not clear on is whether that is fully devolved matter. Automatic registration may not be. If it is, then that for Scottish elections, certainly I would approve of automatic registration for young people. You may wish to come in on my next point as well, which is, secondly, there should be a duty on Scottish public bodies to register people to vote when people engage with them. Indeed, the member may point out to me that that should be an automatic registration when people engage with Scottish public bodies, and I would support that. Of course, that needs to be paired with protections to assure people that being added to the electoral register would not bring adverse consequences from public or private bodies, such as being pursued for debt collection. Scottish Green Group look forward to working with the Minister ahead of Stage 2 on the proposed provisions around disqualification. Safeguarding constituents is obviously a key concern, and the proposed criteria seems like an obvious area for disqualification. We want to make sure that we've fully thought through the detail and potential consequences of creating a power to dismiss those who have been democratically elected by their constituents. But getting all nerdy and technical about elections, election systems and processes is something that the Scottish Greens get very excited about. So we are pleased to participate in this debate today and are very much looking forward to working with the Minister and other members on this bill as it moves forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Slater. I now call on Michael Mara to close on behalf of Scottish Labour. Around 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank you to all members for their participation in the debate today. There are clearly significant challenges that beset our democracy, and not just in this country, but across democratic institutions across the world. And many of those are built on issues of trust. Trust of the populace in that their institutions work for them and that they're responsive to their needs. And much of that is about issues about outcomes, whether people actually feel that their lives are getting better or they're getting worse. Does the political system as it's established work for me? Does it work for my family? Does it work for my community? All very legitimate questions, and frankly at the core as to why people lose trust in these institutions. And that is the stuff of the substantive political debate in which we are engaged at the moment, a general election in a matter of weeks, and of course the political debate that we engage in day to day in this Parliament. And the bill in front of us deals with more of the structures around that that are definitely in need of continuous revision. And they do inform much of those issues of trust, and frankly the structures inform some of the ability for us to represent policy. I think colleagues across the chamber have made very strong points about representation and the people who are elected and actually impacting
on the decisions that we make, the character of those discussions, the outcomes of the policy. So where we set the rules that then determines those outcomes in terms of representation, they will determine, therefore, the level of trust that people have in the longer term, or so the theory goes. But it is right that we revise and review the many technical provisions that the Minister set out in his opening statement. I'm sure we'll go on to more as he closes at the debate today. And Scottish Labour does agree with the principle of reform that we should take action. And there have been many suggestions in the debate today as to how where we might go further and take particular views. And it's clear that the bill will progress as it does in stage two. There will be the opportunity for many of members to make particular influences on it. There are broad opportunities set out by members around diversity. There are specific instances that have been raised by several members brought forward around visually impaired people, and that there's the provisions that could be in place in the short term, certainly ahead of the next Scottish Parliament elections, to make sure that we can build the engagement in that group in society that should be reasonably straightforward. And I hope that the Minister, as he already set out, is certainly engaging with that, but that practical action can be forthcoming. We also, I think, in the debate heard a little bit of exposure, that, but we have to be very careful about the division where the responsibility for some of this lies, whether it sits with government or it sits with Parliament. It's an interesting discussion, but we have to be absolutely clear about making sure that there is the trust for setting the rules sits with Parliament rather than with the government in the first instance. And my colleagues have raised issues of framework bills. The number of framework bills we're seeing through coming through Parliament has grown very significantly, and that presents very significant democratic problems, not just in terms of what we've seen in the Finance Committee in Parliament, the deeply inadequate costing of those bills that are leading to impacts on the public finances, but the fact that so much of these provisions are then to be set in secondary legislation, which has a lower threshold for the engagement of Parliament for scrutiny. And that is a worry for us all. So I think it's right that it's repeated in this debate. I'm happy to take the intervention from Bob Doris.
Bob Doris, remotely for his intervention, please.
I thank Mr. Mara for taking the intervention. I'm just wondering, in terms of the balance between Parliament and government, in relation to Electoral Commission and five-year plans, the responsibility actually sits with the Scottish Parliament corporate body. What's Mr. Mara's position in relation to that?
Mike O'Mara?
I think it's certainly worth some level of consideration. Mr. Whitfield made a contribution on that basis. I do think, actually, at the moment, the government and Parliament seems to have a rather strange idea as to what the corporate body is for, in general terms. That we're asking the corporate body to do things that it's not meant to do or was never established to do, and that we have to actually have a more broader look at what we're asking of the corporate body. And I know that members of the corporate body share those concerns. If I can move towards concluding, Deputy Presiding Officer, there are a couple of other issues I want to touch on very carefully. Those issues around those with limited leave to remain. I was glad to hear the Minister share some of, I think, a constructive conversation around about some of the challenges that arise from those issues, potentially open to abuse from foreign powers, and that we would want to look at that in the broad sense in Stage 2 and explore that more in particular. And I would close, as Martin Whitfield did as the convener of the committee, around the Gould principle and making sure that this work has to be done sufficiently quickly and put in place so that when we engage in that election in 2026, everybody understands the rules upon which it is based and that we can seek to rebuild that trust in our politics.
Thank you, Mr. Mara. I now call on Jeremy Balfour to close on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Around 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I welcome this opportunity to speak in this debate this afternoon? Clearly, there is a fair amount of consensus amongst all the parties in regard to a way forward, and I think it has been helpful as we've reflected on some of the changes that might come at Stage 2 and 3. Annie Wells said that we want an open and accessible election process, and I think that's what we all want, and we want to keep reviewing the situation to make sure that it is open and accessible to everyone who lives here in Scotland, that they can take part not only in voting but also having the opportunity to stand for election. And although there is consensus, undoubtedly there will also be some amendments that come forward both from government and from other parties at Stage 2. And I do want to thank, again, Martin Whitfield and the committee for bringing forward such a detailed report, which I think really did give those of us who hadn't had the opportunity to hear the evidence to have a very good understanding of what some of the issues were. If I can pick up on something made by Pam Duncan Clancy in her contribution, I think she is absolutely right in regard to we do need to make sure, particularly for those with disability, that Parliament is more open and that people do not have a fear that their disability will be used against them if they stand in an election. I have the privilege of being part of a Commonwealth Parliamentary Association for this region, and it's interesting how many people in other jurisdictions who have disability are not willing to declare that because they feel it will affect them. So we, I think, are in a better place, but I think there's still work that can be done. And I, like my colleague Mr Simpson, look forward to seeing other proposals that the member brings forward at stage two. She did touch on the election for office fund. I do think it was a very disappointing that this has not been able to be used for this UK election, and I think it was a backward step by Westminster. I also am not convinced it should be in the discretion of government of whether the fund is there or not. And I would be interested to explore with the Minister whether that we could put this into legislation itself to say that if any Scottish Parliament election or any local authority election, that fund will always be there and funded appropriately by whoever is in government going forward. I do wish the Minister well in regard to his discussions with my colleague Mr Simpson over the summer. I'm sure that will be a delight for him in regard to those conversations. And I really look forward to seeing some detailed proposals coming forward in regard to that. Can I also pick up the remarks made by Daniel Johnson and by Julia Mackay in regard to those with visual impairment? I do think we are taking a very long time over this. Like Julia Mackay, I had the privilege of going to a number of these sessions. I do believe that in the 21st century, there must be something we can do quicker in regard to this. And I would urge all of us in regard to moving forward on this, and if I'm sure the Minister would get support in regard to that from other people. I do think there's just one or two areas I would be interested, maybe not necessarily this afternoon. Oh, sorry, yes.
Julian Mackay.
I want to thank Jeremy Val for taking the intervention, as well as those adaptations for people with visual impairments. There are obviously a range of other impairments that impact people's ability to participate in the democratic process that we haven't even started looking at yet. Would you agree with me that we do need to do much more across the spectrum of disability to actually look at what more we can do to involve people in the democratic process, but in elections and voting themselves?
Jeremy Balfour.
Absolutely. I think hopefully we've moved beyond. If we've got a ramp, it is then accessible. But I still think we have a long way to go. And actually, interestingly, I think in regard to, again, a point made by Pam Duncan Glancy, I do wonder, all of us as our political parties also have to look how we select our candidates, and the process of selection is where we're seeing maybe people from other minorities not coming forward. There are a couple of points I would just briefly like maybe the Minister to reflect on. That is in regard to the duty of returning officers to provide support in regard to those with disability. That is in law within the UK. He reflected that that wasn't necessarily needed. Now, I'm sure most returning officers do a very good job, but I do think if we're reviewing this, there should be some form of legislation to make sure that returning officers do everything that they can to make the polling stations accessible. I also noticed that within the financial memorandum that there are no pilots planned in regard to that. And that does slightly concern me as well, that we've talked about having these pilots in regard to it, but there's nothing within legislation to bring that forward. And I do hope that that will happen quicker. My time is gone. and I do welcome this bill. We will, as Mr Simpson pointed out, be voting for it at stage one, and I look forward with other members to engage in with the Minister to make the bill even better at stage two and three. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call on the Minister to wind up to 7 minutes.
Thank you, President Officer. I'll try and keep my remarks constrained, not least because I was urged to by some unnamed members before, because the canteen apparently closes at 2:30, so I'll try and let them to avail themselves of the opportunity to get themselves fed. Can I thank members for the contributions they've made today? I think this has been a considered debate, a consensual debate. I think that reflects the fact that largely we welcome this legislation. Clearly there are some ideas for further deliberation, consideration. I would reflect that's the usual experience of any legislation, but certainly in so far as this legislation is concerned, we are operating from a shared basis of seeking to refine and improve what we have before us. And in that regard, I very much echo the remarks of Mr Whitfield, that he would... we'll see whether I agree with these remarks, President Officer.
Martin Whitfield.
Perfect. This will allow the member to disagree with me. But would you find it helpful to put on the record in the chamber the Scottish Government's approach towards automaticity of boundary changes, which has been something that has sat around this bill, and it may be able to facilitate its journey forward in an easier way?
Minister.
Yes, so I was going to cover that. I mean, clearly that is an issue that's been raised. The Boundaries Scotland, of course, have raised this as an issue. It's one I'm broadly sympathetic with. I think the idea is one that I recognise and see the merits of. Of course, we would all recognise, be a fairly substantial change from where we are now. So it merits some further consideration. I'm going to engage with the Chair of Boundaries Scotland to begin that process. And that brings me back to the point where I was agreeing with the committee convener that I would similarly encourage people to participate in the process of engaging with this legislation over the coming period in advance of stage two. That starts in this Parliament. I make clear again my willingness to engage with all members, just as I have with Mr Simpson, who I can say to Mr Balfour has been, as usual, effervescent ray of sunshine in his engagement with me, and I'm sure will continue to be. We start off though with a fairly... Mr Robertson, sorry, Mr. I will invite him to the next meeting. He can see for himself. There was a reasonable point, and I do genuinely recognise the point that's been made around who should have ownership of this activity. Should it be, in this instance, the executive, the government, having brought forward the bill? Should it otherwise be apparent? That's a legitimate area for us to consider. I would go back to the point I made earlier. Perfectly possible for Parliament to bring forward its own proposals, and I would be encouraging of them to do so where there is a sense that there is a desire to do so, and of course the Government would engage with that process. But I would also reflect on what we've laid out in this bill. We're not trying to take on ownership of the process of elections. We are seeking to refine and improve that process. And in fact, if you look at what we have laid out in the bill, we are ceding some responsibility. So we're looking to put on a statutory footing the Electoral Management Board. I know the committee's looked for more information about that. We will provide that. But, for example, some of the responsibilities that are presently in the gift of the Scottish Government around the procurement of electronic voting, counting rather, it will be transferred to be the responsibility of the Electoral Management Board. That's us ceding some responsibility to another party. If you look at the activity that we're undertaking in relation to the Electoral Commission, asking them to have their 5-year plan for their devolved activities, we're making sure it's Parliament that has the responsibility for scrutinising that, not the government. I also very much agreed with the convener when he correctly said that this is not what we are increasingly hearing the increased use of the terminology, a framework bill. This bill contains a substantial range of measures on the face of the bill set out in primary legislation. It is, of course, the case now, and it is not an illegitimate thing for there to continue to be regulation-making powers to be taken forward through secondary legislation. That's normal, that's sensible, because things develop, things change. I'm not ignoring you, Mr Johnson, I'm just finishing this point. I will come to Mr Johnson in a moment. It's not unusual for that to be the case, because, of course, the law changes and we have to be adaptive and responsible, and bringing back primary legislation every time it creates a certain burden on Parliament to go through that process. And of course, secondary legislation is rightly scrutinised by Parliament as well. And what I will say is, just as I've made a similar commitment to the committee around bringing forward details on the constitution of the Electoral Management Board, we'll be doing the same for secondary legislation. I'll give way to Mr Johnson.
Daniel Johnson.
So I'm very grateful to the Minister for giving way. Let me withdraw my a description of this as a framework bill. But if we look at the mechanisms for secondary legislation, one of the issues is around the ability of Parliament to scrutinise, produce reports and amend secondary legislation. And given the sensitivity around the function of elections, I just wondered if the Minister might A, reflect on that point in general, and B, maybe set out how he might bring forward draft proposals to enable members around Parliament, in particular the SPPA committee, so that those views and thoughts may be incorporated in the final draft that the government puts before Parliament for that secondary legislation, given it's so critical to so many of the proposals in this bill.
Minister.
Well, I welcome his newfound and correct recognition that this is not a framework bill. But I would make the point, of course, that the DPLRC, the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, is starting to undertake some work broadly in this area and may have some conclusions reached. But I would make the point again, I have already committed to providing that additional information to the committee for them to scrutinise further. A number of other issues have been raised, Presiding Officer. I don't know how much time I have to go through them all, but there are issues raised around the matter of those with leave to remain standing for election. Mr Simpson raised that, others mentioned it. I would make the point the UK Government itself has signed treaties allowing nationals of Denmark, Luxembourg, Poland, Portugal and Spain with limited leave to remain to stand in council elections, so it is not unusual or peculiar to Scotland, should we choose to legislate in this area. Jill Mackay asked us to consider going further in relation to who might be able to vote. Of course, I would make the observation, I'm sure she would agree, we already have a very generous voting franchise in Scotland, one of the most generous in the world. But of course, we're happy to meet to see what else we might be able to do. Bob Doris talked about the issue of rejected or spoiled ballot papers. He knows I know Canal Ward well, because I cut my teeth campaigning alongside Mr Doris in the Glasgow Maryhill constituency back in the day. If what he has talked about in terms of there being a statute duty for the Electoral Commission to do work on spoiled ballot papers, we are exploring an amendment placing a duty on the Commission to report on what they and other bodies, such as returning officers, they have a role to play here, of course, as well, are doing to improve voter education, specifically in relation to reducing the number of spoiled ballot papers. There was discussion from a number of members around the importance of the pilots that are being taken forward. I welcome the fact that people are recognising their importance. They can continue to inform and improve our process. I would say I think it's important. And similarly, and a similar point in relation to the Engagement Fund, it's important that we do not become overly prescriptive as to what they should be. We should embed flexibility within our system, because despite our collective wit, there will be issues that none of us have yet considered that will come forward in the future. But for those who raised the issues, such as Pam Duncan Glancy and Jeremy Balfour, around what we might be able to do in terms of improving diversity through pilots, through funding mechanisms, I'm happy to meet with them too. Eleanor Whittam talked about the engender survey, which I am aware of. I recognise the recommendation around the collection of data and information. Of course, we undertake our candidate survey already. and Gender noted that the response rate to our survey is low. I agree, 28%, despite significant resource commitment from the government, despite the support of returning officers, despite the support of political parties, academics, COSLA and others, it remained at 28%. I would say creating a statutory duty in of itself might not increase that response rate. Wales, there is a duty. The response rate to their 2022 local government candidate survey was just 12%. And our view as a government is that the exercise demonstrates the importance of continuing to press the UK government to commence Section 106 of the Equality Act 2010, which would, if commenced, require registered political parties to publish information relating to the protected characteristics of applicants for nomination and or candidates in elections to the UK Parliament, the Scottish Parliament and the Senate. We will continue to pursue that with the UK government. Presiding Officer, I'm very pleased that today we seem to see wide-ranging support for the bill. We are considering electoral reform during a year in which not only do we celebrate a quarter century of the first election to this Parliament, but there will be over 2 billion voters going to the polls in over 50 countries, including in Scotland and the UK, a week today. Public participation in free and fair elections are vital in a democracy, and this bill will help strengthen elections in Scotland. And I urge Parliament to support the motion in my name this afternoon.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Scottish Elections Representation and Reform Bill, Stage 1. It is now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of Motion 13523 in the name of Shona Robison on a financial resolution for the Scottish Elections Representation and Reform Bill. And I call on Shona Robison, Cabinet Secretary, to move the motion.
Formally moved.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And the question on this motion will be put at decision time. And I am minded under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders to bring forward a motion that decision time be brought forward to now. And I call on the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion.
Aye, officer.
Thank you. And the question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed, and there are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that Motion 13746, in the name of Martin Whitfield, on behalf of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee, on Standing Order Rule Changes, Procedures on Consent in relation to UK Parliament Bills, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next question is that Motion 13758, in the name of Jamie Hepburn, on Scottish Elections, Representation and Reform Bill at Stage 1, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. And the final question is that Motion 13523, in the name of Shona Robison, on a financial resolution for the Scottish Elections, Representation and Reform Bill, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. That concludes decision time. I'll take this opportunity to wish all members and staff a good recess, and we will now move on to members' business.